From a long view of the history of mankind, seen from, say, 10,000 years from now, there can be a little doubt that the most significant event of the 19th century will be judged as Maxwell's discovery of the laws of electrodynamics. The American Civil War will pale into the provincial insignificance in comparison with this important scientific event of the same decade. R.P. Feynman, Lecture on Physics, Richard Feynman, Volume 2. Now, I mention the unification of the electricity and magnetism that Mr. Maxwell had discovered in the 1800s. Because the same thing happened again when we were constructing this weak theory. This was discovered by all of the characters, Weinberg and Salam and Grashow and T. Hoods, that there was a unification between the weak force and the electromagnetic forces. So what did that mean? It means that this weak force, which seems completely different in every respect, was very just like electricity and magnetism, viewed from the different perspective. It's always beautiful and wonderful when different things actually turns out to be unified, different facets of the one fundamental, deeper underlying object. Physicists love that, and I think this unification of the weak and electromagnetic forces was one of the compelling arguments for people to pay attention to this theory and take it seriously. At first, the theory, although it was highly predictive, wasn't at first making the predictions that changed any connections to data. But as the years went by, the theory was more and more sort of seriously verified mathematically. Nowadays, it's incredibly well tested, but in the early days, I think people paid more attention to it because of its aesthetic character than anything else. Right, aesthetic, yes. When you have a gauge field theory, you predict the existence of the force carriers. When Weinberg and Salam and Grashow were looking at their theory, they said, gauge invariance not only predicts the existence of the W particle, which is electrically charged and become very massive in the presence of the Higgs field, but our theory also predicts the existence of another force carrier, which I'm going to call the Z particle. Yes, Weinberg calls it the Z particle, maybe because it has zero charge. Zero charge, ZZZ, zero, ZZ. Or maybe he says because it's the last letter of the English alphabet. He thought, this has to be the last new particle we are going to have to propose. It turns out there have been others since then. Wow. But it was a nice dream. So the Z particle is a consequence of the mathematics of this theory. And what is it saying? It's a new force carrier, which means there is a new force, okay? This is really wild. You are not only predicting a new particle of nature, you can state with some mathematical certainty what its mass is. Mass is the ma equal f of m. Unlike the fundamental quarks and leptons, whose mass cannot be predicted from the gauge field theory, the mass of the force carrier can be predicted from the theory because it comes from gauge symmetry, right? So you could predict the mass of the Z particle and the mass of the W particles, so we have numbers that were too high to look for right away in an accelerator. We need higher energy machines than were available in 1967, so this just goes into the literature as a prediction about how nature is. It's even a bigger deal than that. It's not just one more new particles, it's a new force, okay? Think about this. Particle physicists have this worldview that what do we have? There is a gravity, there is a electromagnetism, there is a strong nuclear force, and there is a weak force. That's it. Four fundamental forces of nature. Now, what we've seen is the story is in the some ways more beautiful because electricity, magnetism, and the weak force are really all one. Really? Electricity, magnetism, and the weak force are really all one. So there is a simplification, but also there is something brand new. Because the weak force itself can be manifested, not just in the way we had always seen, transforming one nucleus into another. This Z boson is electrically neutral. Wow! So it's a non-transformative weak force. It's like a neutrino could just walk into an electron and bounce off of it. Electrons can bounce off of each other electrically, and now we have a way that a particle could bounce off of each other weakly. And nobody had ever thought about this before. It would have all sorts of experimental signatures. You could look for a neutrino bouncing off of particles. People immediately said, if this is real, then we have to be able to see this in an experiment, and it didn't take very long. It was in 1973 when, at the European facility, CERN, the European Center for Nuclear Research, the acronym uses the French words for the in its name. They had a neutrino beamed by that. At CERN, they could beam those neutrino beam right into a big bubble chamber and see the events. Right. They saw what they called the weak natural currents. Weak neutral currents. They called it weak because it's a weak force. Neutral because it's a zero particle being transferred virtually back and forth between the neutrino and the target. And why was it called currents? I don't know. It was just a word. So weak neutral currents was a new force of nature. Okay. Makes sense. You have to appreciate both the sort of the sweet success of this theory and also the hubris of the theory who are proposing new particles. It's not like the old days, alright? Dirac discovers antimatter, but he was sort of timid about proposing it because it was too wild. Pauli with a neutrino was also too timid about proposing it, even with quarks in the early 1960s. After Murray Gell-Mann published his paper, then he gave talks and said, I don't really believe they are real. I just think they are mathematical framework. But you know, Steve Weinberg went out there and said, oh, you are going to find weak natural currents. You are going to find the Z particle. You are going to find the W right where we predict because the mathematics looks good. He was pretty confident. It came together in just such an elegant way. The theory was unified and it looks just like a QCD, so everything really seems to tie together in a beautiful way. So what about the discovery of W and the Z? It looks like a while. The Americans had kind of taken over from the Europeans. Europeans had dominated this physics story in the late 1800s and the early 1900s. We were just puppies back then. It kind of turned around after World War II. We started building the big accelerators and were putting big money into particle physics. We were making all the big discoveries. I think the Europeans, at a certain point in the 1970s, thought they should be big competitors again, and they pulled together. It was a brilliant stroke. Instead of the Germans just building a German facility, all of the Europeans got together. They built a European National Center. The ring actually lands between the France and Switzerland, so the particles go back and forth across the border as they land through the giant accelerating ring at CERN. There was a physicist, an Italian physicist named Carlo Rubbia, who took the lead in the project to find the W and find the Z. What we are talking about is to put enough energy into a small region of the space that you don't have a virtual force carrier, but you actually produce one. you see a little track evidence, direct evidence, in some modern analog of the bubble chamber that this particle is real. And it has the charge and the mass and everything that you expected. Carlo Rubier is quite an interesting character. There was a book written about this story called Novel Dreams, which I enjoyed. It's not a technical book at all. It's about the very strong personality of Carlo Rubier. He had to step on lots of toes to put together multi-million dollar projects like this. He had to convince a lot of people that it was the right thing to do. In the end, he was quite successful. The Europeans and Carlo Rubier got their Nobel Prizes. The discovery was made in the 1980s. 1983 was the year of discovery of the W, and just 6 months later they produced a Z boson. Some people don't like the book about Carlo Rubier. I think it's somewhat critical just on the personal level of this character. You know, when you are a strong personality, you always step on the people's toes. But I suggest reading those kinds of books as a way of seeing the human aspect of the story, which so often is just impersonal and formal. The neutral current has been seen now many times, and the Z boson, in fact, have been so many times I would call it probably one of the most well-studied particles ever in the history of particle physics. Shortly after its discovery, the people at Stanford said, you know, we could build an upgrade. It's the same idea of taking an electron and positrons and annihilating them, but this time we are going to up the energy so that the total energy of the E plus E minus pair exactly matches the mass E equal ma square. The mass energy of a Z boson, and we will have a little Z factory. We are just going to be producing nothing but Zetas after Zetas after Zetas, and we can see how they decay. That was the experiment that told us there apparently were only three types of neutrinos. Because when the Zetas decay, they love to decay into the neutrino-antineutrino pairs, and you can see how likely it is for the Z to decay. After that, actually, shortly after that, CERN built a Z factory, and now they are producing millions upon millions of Z particles. So extremely well verified and matched with this theory, which I haven't named, is the electroweak theory. The electroweak theory of Weinberg, Slam, and Glashow is a mathematical field theory that's like the analog of QCD. It put together electricity and the weak force unified them, so there was no more QED all by itself. It's a part of electroweak theory. Wow! So now, we really are at a state where we can just take stock of what we have seen, what we've been talking about throughout this entire course. What we have in our hands now are all the ingredients of the standard model. I wish it weren't called the standard model. It is a standard theory of the particle physics. A model, to me, implies kind of the crude collection of the ideas that gives you a qualitative understanding. A theory, to me, is a mathematical framework with well-defined constituents and sets the set of rules for computing observable facts. In particular, a tested theory, is exactly what we have with the standard model. Nobody calls it the standard theory, but that's really what it is, huh? Let me try to sort of reiterate the ingredients. We have a fundamental particle of nature which appear to be point-like to the best of our knowledge even today. They come into classes, quarks and leptons. The quarks are all strongly interacting. They are colored objects, and there are six of them, up, down, and then heavier, strange, charm, and then a third generation. Heavier still, top and bottom. over in the leptons, you have the electrons and its neutrino, a muon and the muon neutrino, the tau and the tau neutrino, again getting heavier and less stable, more radioactive as you go down in the table or up in mass. Those are the ingredients. Those are the fundamental particles of the world. The forces are the electroweak force, which is described by the electroweak theory, and the strong force, which is described by the quantum chromodynamics. Those theories are consistent with everything we've ever learned in the last 300 or 400 years about science. They are consistent with Isaac Newton, although they go deeper. They are consistent with Maxwell and his theories of electricity and magnetism. But they go deeper. They are consistent with the quantum mechanics and Albert Einstein's relativity. They include the principle of the field and all of the logical consequences when you have a field that also exists in a quantum mechanical world. These theories predict the new particle of nature, which we call force carriers. Force carriers. They predict the photon. They predict the photon, the W plus and minus. There is both charges and the Z particles. They are electroweak force carriers. Then you have the gluons, which are the carriers of strong force, and that is a standard model. Well. From those ingredients, you can calculate the observable consequences of any imaginable subatomic physics experiments. In the principle, it's not just subatomic physics. For example, if you take two hydrogen atoms and combine them together, it's just electrons orbiting around up and down quarks. And the forces are all described by this theory, the standard model. So, in the principle and in the practice, you can calculate the properties and the structure of, let's say, a hydrogen molecule. Hydrogen molecule, right? Yes. We can keep building now. We can argue what the properties and the structures are of a more complicated molecule. The more particles you put together, the together it gets to work out the mass. Mathematics and solve for the detailed final answer. Chemists nowadays use quantum mechanics in order to describe and quantum field theory to describe chemical reactions and to help us to design and understand novel chemical elements. So this story is really is tying in to more complicated sciences. Right. As a reductionist, you can at least imagine in principle following this chain on up. Maybe we could understand DNA and its properties by examining the quarks that make up the nuclei and the electrons that are orbiting around them. In practice, it's just too formidable a problem. DNA is a very complicated molecule with lots and lots of constituents, and it's just too tough to really to directly from the bottom level up to such a complicated level. But in the principle, we should be able to. People are making progresses, and you can imagine that all of the biological properties that arise from the DNA can be understood at some level from this fundamental underlying theory, the standard model of particle physics. Right. So I think we are talking about what is really grand human intellectual achievement. It stands out in the history of the evolution of human thinking. Along with Isaac Newton's understanding about force and the name of gravity, or Albert Einstein's insight into the nature of space and time, the standard model of particle physics is such an achievement. It's really a very elegant and closed mathematical system. You know, it's a shame it doesn't fit on a t-shirt. If the standard model fits on the t-shirt, then I would say we are done. You know, we've got the fundamental theory of nature. Alas, it takes several pages of a textbook to write out all the details. And in fact, there are still some issues. I will not call them the problem. We are going to be talking in a future lecture about why we don't just close the book, you know, publish it, set it on the shelf, and go off and study other stuff. In fact, particle physics is still very much alive. There are lots of interesting problems and questions. We are now struggling to understand this theory itself at some deeper level. I don't think we are trying to prove it wrong anymore. It might happen, you know. We are not trying to prove Newton wrong either. 300 or 400 years later, he's correct, but Newton's theory has been improved and deepened, and I think that's the state we are in now with the standard model of particle physics. Wow! So particle physics is a new Newtonian classical physics at that time, which is so rational, which is so radical, yet truth, consistent, coherent. There are still large number of quantities like the change of the electron and the charge of the electron and the mass of a strange quark and so on. In fact, if you count it up, there are about 23 such numbers that don't come out of theory. You have to go in the lab and measure them and put them into the theory because it's a renormalizable theory and that's the price you pay. Ha ha ha. 23 numbers, 6 quarks, 6 electrons. It is a little bit complicated. It's simple enough that I sort of view it as a lovely, simple theory. But I can understand this sort of sense that maybe someday we will be able to understand even this level of complexity in terms of something simpler. Still, it's a nice dream. Thank you!